Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
My name is Brenda Negri. Since 2009, I've owned, raised, bred, and trained a variety of breeds of livestock guardian dogs here on my ranch. Livestock guardian dog breeds are ancient land races. In their countries of origin, they were used by shepherds as means to protect livestock from depredation from large predators. In 1976, a man by the name of Ray Coppinger brought over the very first livestock guardian dogs to America. And under the guise of research under Hampshire University, he and his wife Lorna began what was called the Livestock Guardian Dog Project. The Coppingers, using a sheep station, brought over several breeds of livestock guardian dog puppies and started raising them with sheep. And this was the beginning of the use of livestock guardian dogs in America and promoted as non-lethal predator deterrents. In other words, instead of using traps or shooting predators, using non-lethal means such as livestock guardian dogs enabled shepherds, commercial sheepmen and goatmen, cattlemen to live side by side with predators and not have to kill them all in order to protect their livestock. The dogs served as deterrents. The early researchers promoted hands-off rearing of these dogs. They discouraged socialization and handling of the dogs, which was not good. It was not a good idea. And subsequently, farmers and ranchers have had issues and problems using these dogs in that mostly based on what they were assuming they were supposed to do. They would take a puppy and just throw it in the livestock and basically walk away. Well, that's not how you raise these dogs. My breeding program strongly emphasized handling and socialization of pups from puppyhood, which went against the grain of what was being preached by most researchers, including the Coppingers, who were the hands-off variety. I, on the other hand, handled the pups extensively from birth. It in no way, shape, or form impacted their guarding ability in a negative way. And I know some people say, well, if you let a livestock guardian dog in the house, it won't guard livestock. The heck it won't. Some of my best guardian dogs for livestock have been dogs that spent time in the house, that spent time on the couch, no less. And in fact, I will say, and I will have people back me up with this, I know, that it actually intensified their urge to protect and guard because they felt even a stronger familial relationship with me. And I'm taken in now to their circle of what they're protecting. It's not just the sheep, it's not just the cattle, it's not just the goats. They're protecting me, the house, the whole property. Anything comes on here, it's toast, unless I give it permission to come in here. It's their ability to do this, and which is where people need to understand that they've got to trust the dog and its instincts and give it that opportunity to show them what they can do. The old ways of raising these dogs hands off is really starting, thank God, to fall out of favor. The methods that Coppinger promoted and used are now seriously frowned upon. Even the American sheep industry came out a few years ago with a best management practices manual for shepherds and for sheepmen. And even they have come out against the hands off, don't touch the puppies when you're raising them stuff. Nobody does that anymore. I know in the almost 9 years that I've been breeding these dogs, I've proved that wrong time and time again, because I've had pups grow up to be fantastic guardians of all kinds of livestock and poultry, and they were handled from birth. It's really important to socialize and handle puppies, because you don't want a dog that's going to grow up to be aggressive to people, that's going to be untrustworthy, that's going to be afraid of its own shadow. And that's what you get when you raise up pups with no human interaction. They may bond to the stock and stay with the stock, but Katie bar the door, if you get close to the livestock, they're liable to attack you. You don't know, because they're unpredictable and unstable, and they fear humans. So what you're looking for in a livestock guardian dog, you're just not looking for a big dog that's going to run out there and scare off predators. You want a dog with a stable mind, that's self-confident, that's trustworthy. Core principle of the livestock guardian dog has never been to hunt down and attack and kill predators. They were never meant to do that. These breeds were meant to be used as a deterrent, to live with the flocks or stay with the flocks in their native countries and deter predators from attacking them. Occasionally you do have conflicts, that's inevitable. Occasionally you have death. You have wolves coming in and killing LGDs, but that's not the norm. Typically, when that happens, it has a lot to do with the fact that the rancher is to be blamed for not running enough or the right kinds of livestock guardian dogs. In America, farmers, they're always cutting corners, a lot of them. And they want to get by with the least amount that they can, and so they underdog their operation. And what happens is then a pack of coyotes will come in and take out a single livestock guardian dog. Unfortunately, when Coppinger began his studies back in 1976, they didn't talk about running the right numbers of dogs back then. Subsequently, you've got a lot of farmers and ranchers in America who they run out and buy their one LGD and start running it, and then they act shocked and wonder why the dog gets taken out by a pack of coyotes or a pack of wild or feral domesticated dogs or wolves, because these dogs were never meant to be run solo. They should be run in numbers, pairs, trios, quads, more. People often ask me, how do you know how many dogs to run? And I have a cryptic response to that. I quote the old Spanish shepherd who says, you know you're running enough dogs when you stop losing livestock. There is no pat set answer. There's no percentage formula that you can use. You know, well, if I have 200 head of sheep, I need to run two dogs. It doesn't work that way. There's many factors that come into play when you decide how many dogs to run. First of all, what kind of livestock do you run? Is it a type of livestock that bunches together or spreads out more? What's the terrain and country that you're running in? Is it wide open flat prairies? Is it steep mountainous terrain? Is it covered with brush and forest and trees? Or is it sporadically dotted with a few trees here and there? Is it rolling countryside? What's the line of sight? How far can you see? How far can a dog see? What kind of fencing is your stock under? Is it open range? Is it really well fenced, tight paddocks, or large, you know, thousands of acres? All these factors have to come into play to decide how many dogs is enough. And then you've got to think about what kind of dogs to run, because livestock guardian dog breeds don't all work the same. You have some breeds that are more aggressive, more prone to traveling farther away from their flocks to do what I call perimeter patrol. Some of the more far-ranging breeds have a tendency to be the Turkish breeds, the Akbash, the Turkish Kangal, the Anatolian. They're more inclined to leave their flocks and go on a perimeter patrol or go hunting predators. And then you've got the more close guarding breeds that don't want to be out there. They want to stay right next to their sheep or their goats or their cattle and lay down and bed down with them. Closer guarding breeds are breeds such as the Spanish Mastiff, the Pyrenean Mastiff, the Italian Maremma, and the Polish Tatra. Those are all breeds that are known for staying closer with livestock. When I talk about the disconnect in America between a lot of commercial producers who just treat the dogs like this, run them almost half wild out there. We had a case here in Nevada years ago where a guy pulled his sheep off of a big operation, left behind a bunch of Great Pyrenees guardian dogs. These dogs subsequently started inbreeding and went wild. And then you had buckaroos that were checking cattle in that area. And the dogs were attacking these men on horseback, literally attacking them. They'd gone completely wild. And they had to bring in a professional sharpshooter in a plane to go out there and shoot these dogs. Well, that's atrocious. That kind of management is horrible and should be always frowned upon. I've been an outspoken advocate for running these dogs in a responsible manner since I started. It's garnered me a lot of hate mail and a lot of enemies because people don't like it when you start lifting the curtain and seeing what's going on underneath and it's not too good, and they prefer you didn't talk about it. And I've been an outspoken critic of people who run these dogs irresponsibly without socializing them, feeding them, taking care of them like they should be. The book that I'm writing is about halfway done. It's titled The Way of the Pack, Understanding and Living with Livestock Guardian Dogs. The whole focus of this book is going to be kind of a wake-up call to people to say, hey, you got to come back to the old ways here, the ancient old ways of the shepherd who had a respect for the land, a respect for the livestock, and a respect for the predators and nature. And you've got to stop disconnecting from that, and you got to get reconnected with it to really truly understand and use these dogs in the way that they were meant to be used. And in doing so, you're going to have a much deeper and far more satisfactory relationship with these dogs, and it's going to work out much better. I've been asked, how is it that livestock guardian dogs' temperament are so conducive towards living this way of the pack? I think it's because by nature, livestock guardian dogs want to protect something. They are nurturing by nature. They're not suspicious. They're not overly aggressive. They're not afraid. They're courageous dogs, willing to put their lives on the line for something. And they're because they want to protect something. And that in and of itself, the grandeur of that is what makes them such great dogs. They don't want to just take care of themselves and their own needs. They want to go outside of that and protect a newborn lamb or some baby chicks or a cow. And it takes a certain amount of greatness to be able to do that. And that's what makes these dogs, to me, the some of the most wonderful breeds of dogs in the world, is that intrinsic nature to help, to guard, to protect.